Det er ikke første gangen det blir arrangert ytringsfrihetsdager ved biblioteket i Skien. Første gangen var i 2012. Da var det masse flotte gjester her fra fjernene og et flott program. Da var det med utgangspunkt i et sånt nasjonalt initiativ fra Nasjonalbiblioteket, så det skjedde et lignende arrangement flere plasser i landet. Men denne gangen så gjør vi det fordi vi har lyst til å gjøre det her i Skien. To grunner til det. Den første grunnen er at vi er en fri by for forfulgte forfattere. Det vil si at gjennom 10 år, vi var med helt i begynnelsen når dette nettverket ICORN, International Cities of Refuge Network, ble opprettet. Og da, blant annet på initiativ fra Salman Rushdie og en del andre forfattere. I samarbeid med PEN. Men den gangen så var jo mye motivasjon for at Skien skulle bli en friby, at Henrik Ibsen kom fra Skien. En viktig fritenker og en forfatter som fremdeles blir brukt og inspirerer folk over hele verden til å kjempe for ytringsfrihet, for likhet mellom kjønnene og mange andre viktige saker. Så, vi tenker sånn, ingen plass mer naturlig at det er ytringsfrihetsdag enn i Skien, og det finnes ikke fra før, så da lager vi det. Og så er det også dette med ICORN, eller Friby-nettverket, det gir en utrolig tilfang til fantastiske, modige, hva skal jeg si, velformulerte og inspirerende personer fra hele verden som bor her i Norge og i Skandinavia. Ja. Så derfor så har vi i kveld besøk fra Bø, for det er jo en friby, og vi har to av våre egne her i kveld da, for friforfattere. En av de skal vi møte, som er den aktive, som vi sier, fordi han er fribyforfatter 2 år i Norge, og så får en oppholdstillatelse permanent hvis den ønsker det etterpå. Og så den som er den aktive friforfatteren i Skien nå, det er Tutul, som sitter her fremme, som kommer fra Bangladesh. Da skal vi fortelle mer om etterpå. Nå skal jeg bare si litt mer, fordi ytringsfrihetsdagene, det er jo en kjempefin ting å samarbeide om. Det er mange som er interessert i å sette fokus på dette. Blant annet Amnesty, som jobber med det hver eneste dag, hele tiden. Derfor er de med, og der bak er det en stand, der det går an å signere, det håper jeg alle gjør. Det er 2 forskjellige underskriftskampanjer som blir fokusert på. Passende nok, Aserbajdsjan, Khadija Ismailova. Hun er, det er sikkert noen som kan uttale det bedre enn meg her, men hun er forfatter, nei, journalist mener jeg, som har ble dømt til 3,5 års betinget fengsel. Hun satt i fengsel helt frem til i vår, da hadde hun sett noen måneder, og så klarte hun å bli satt fri, blant annet etter press fra Amnesty, men hun har fremdeles dommen over seg, så hun er ikke frikjent, men hun er ikke i fengsel. Så det er den ene kampanjen. Den andre kampanjen, den er for journalisten Beksanov, mener jeg, unnskyld. Muhammad Beksanov. Han er fra Uzbekistan, og han er den forfatteren, nei, jeg sier feil hele tiden, journalisten som har sittet lengst fengslet av alle i verden. Hvor mange år var det? Husker du det? Siden 1999. Så da kan du signere deg der nede. Og så i løpet av dagene her så kommer det til å komme med arrangement som er i samarbeid med Spriten Forlag. I morgen blir det boklansering. Det kommer arrangement i samarbeid med Teater Ibsen. Som på lørdag, der blir en samtale om brand i et ytringsfrihetsperspektiv. Og på mandag så er det ungdomsarrangement. Hashtag unghverdagkampanjen har gått i høst. Og den blir finale på mandag da. I samarbeid med blant annet Team Fritid og andre som jobber med ungdom og ytringer og sånt her i kommunen. Så, da må jeg si bare kort introduksjon Altså, dette en todelt kveld. Aserbajdsjan først, så Bangladesh. Idrak, som sitter der nede og snakker. Ja, det er veldig bra. Han må bare snakke. Han kommer fra Aserbajdsjan og har vært i Norge siden 2014. Journalist. 15, ja. Beklager. 15. Internasjonalt renommert journalist som måtte flykte til Norge, eller først via mange andre, som vanlig. Men han kom til Norge, fikk fri trygghet i Bø, og jobber nå i Bø Blad, blant annet. Ja. Men jobber selvsagt også på internett og via sånn satellitt-TV og sånn, for situasjonen hjemme i Aserbajdsjan. Det som så utrolig flott, som passer så godt for oss, det at han tilfeldigvis da hadde besøkt denne veko her. Han hadde sagt ja til å komme, og så fikk han besøk av Leila Yunus og Arif Yunus, som da er to andre veldig høyt profilerte menneskerettighetsforkjempere fra Aserbajdsjan. Så de er også her i kveld. Begge to sitter fengslet på helt grunnløse anklager i Aserbajdsjan. Og kom fri fra fengsel i vår, vel, begge to?
Ja,
begge to. Etter å ha sett i 10 måneder og litt kortere da, men under veldig harde forhold, og måtte flykte og bor nå i Amsterdam. Så, da viser jeg først av alt som en introduksjon til Aserbajdsjan, en film som Idrak har klippet ihop, som gir litt bakgrunn.
Melodi Grand Prix-finalen skal holdes. Landene grenser til det Kaspiske hav i øst, Russland i nord, Armenia og Georgia i vest, og Iran i sør. Etter Sovjets fall ble Aserbajdsjan en egen republikk, og har siden den tid vært selvstendig. I tillegg omfatter landene enklaven Nagorno-Karabakh. En enklav er en del av en stat som har omringet av et fremmed territorium. I dag er det våpenhvile, men konflikten mellom Armenia og Aserbajdsjan er fremdeles svært spent.
Hello, I'm Marianne Mashiri, BBC World News, our top stories. The latest reports say Azerbaijan has declared a ceasefire after fighting continued overnight between Azerbaijani and Armenian forces in the Nagorno-Karabakh region.
Internationally, Nagorno-Karabakh is considered a part of Azerbaijan, but the territory was lost to Armenian forces in the 1990s. Despite a 1994 ceasefire, clashes along the front line are frequent, but the latest fighting marks a new level in hostilities between the two countries. Rehan Dimitri, BBC News.
Aserbajdsjan en republikk styrt av den 51 år gamle presidenten Ilham Alijev. Alijev tok over makten etter sin far, som frem til 2003 var president i landet. Da Ilham Alijevs far regjerte, utnevnte han Alijev til statsminister og sørget for at sønnen også ble presidentkandidat. Ifølge de offisielle resultatene vant Alijev valget med 76,8% av stemmene, men internasjonale valgobservatører erklærte at valget ikke hadde vært fritt og rettferdig, og dette førte til arrangerte gatedemonstrasjoner fra opposisjonen som ble slått brutalt ned.
Thank you. Клянусь достойно служить своему народу.
For øyeblikket er det bare Saudi-Arabia og Iran som har større oljeressurser enn Aserbajdsjan. Norske Statoil er etter British Petroleum den største investoren i landet og har investert 20 milliarder kroner i olje- og gassutvinning. Landet rangeres som et av de mest korrupte landene i verden, og massiv korrupsjon på alle nivåer gjør at pengeressursene er svært skjevt fordelt. Til tross for bred kontakt med europeiske land, medlemskap i Europarådet og store investeringer fra blant annet Storbritannia og Norge, har respekten for menneskerettslige forpliktelser sunket i Aserbajdsjan. Med frykt for opptøyer inspirert av den arabiske våren, har myndighetene strammet kraftig inn i innbyggernes rettigheter. Organisasjoner som jobber med menneskerettigheter og demokrati har blitt utsatt for press og trakassering, og flere organisasjoner har i løpet av de siste årene blitt stengt. Blant annet menneskerettighetshuset i Baku, som var støttet med norske midler. Pressefriheten i Aserbajdsjan er også begrenset, og mange journalister opplever vold, trakassering og trusler. Journalister ble fengslet, banket opp og drept for å skrive kritisk om korrupsjon og dårlig forhold.
Siste bilde der, han som lå med refleksvesten, det var Idrak. Så nå skal han få komme fram og fortsette å fortelle litt selv.
Tusen takk. Ja, Aserbajdsjan, jeg prøver å fortelle mer i den filmen. Ja, Aserbajdsjan er et gammelt sovjetisk land. Også har masse olje, masse gass, masse penger. I min land bor nesten 10 millioner mennesker. Også har konflikt, Nagorno-Karabakh-konflikt. Heydar Aliyev kommer å bli president etter Abul Fazil Tsipras. Han blir første azerisk president etter gamle sovjetperioden. Bare Aserbajdsjan smakt demokrasi et halvt år. Men i den perioden Russland tilbyr Aserbajdsjan, dere må ta vei til Russland. De har lagt en ny lag med gamle sovjetlander, SNG, det er sammen som EU, det er russisk EU. Men azerisk president takker med Russland og sier nei, 300 år vi blir okkupert, vi nå trenger ikke Russland. Vi skal til Europa, til Amerika, til Europa. Vi ønsker å ta vei til demokrasi. Og Russland har begynt i forskjellige lander, også i Kaukasus, tre krig. Nagorno-Karabakh, abkhazisk og også asetinsk mot Georgia, mot Armenia og Aserbajdsjan. Selvfølgelig Russland har hjulpet Armenia. Armenia har okkupert 20% azerisk jord. Det er nesten 1 million mennesker blir flyktning fra sin land. Det er masse folk protesterer og kommer en ex-KGB-general, Heydar Aliyev, sammen som en engel. Folk også tenkte han er en gamle politik, han kjenner alt, og han blir president. Han blir president etter kort tid, han blir en diktatur. När han är död kommer det att hans son Ilham Aliyev bli president. Selvfølgelig dere har sett på den korte filmen i hvilken vei han blir president. Også en måned siden han faktisk har lagt i Aserbajdsjan en ny grunnlov. På den nye grunnlov fant han faktisk er monark. Ja, det er uten valg, det er bare heter valg. Det är Azerbaijan inte har någon valg. OBSE och så andra i international organisation känner att Azerbaijan inte har normal valg. Bara fake valg. Ja, och efter två och ett halvt år sedan när började Ryssland mot Ukraina en krig, när Ukraina också tar väg till absolut till Europa. Och där också dere känner här krig i Donbass och Lugansk och så där har massa problem. Och Ilham Aliyev tänker att Amerika och Europa gör ingenting. Faktiskt Ukraina i den krigen alena. Och han tar absolut väg till Moskva, till Ryssland. Och han begynte stänga alla mänskliga rättigheter frivilliga centralerna NGO också fri aviser, fri tv-kanal, fri radio. Faktiskt i den perioden i Azerbaijan inte fungerat någon fri tv eller fri radio. I 2009 i Azerbaijan blev stängt Radio Liberty, BBC och Voice America. Det ja, inte terror. Ja, och efter men i Azerbaijan fungerar lite grann från frihet den frivilliga central NGO och så bitte lite aviser. Också någon internet, tv och andra ting. Han arrest alla. Också på fake criminal case. För exempel, två heroin sitter där. Det är spion från Armenien, spion från USA, spion från Europa, kanske från Norge också. Också det är väldigt dålig människa, det betalar inte skatt. Det är allt fake. Och öppnar en kriminal case, och så den kriminal case kallas nästan 50 år fängsling. När myndigheterna arresterat politiskt fångade, det slår väldigt dåligt. Och så där, de inte slår bara politiker, det slår också andra fångade. För exempel, den gamla damen, Leila Yunus, när hon sitter i fängslet, hon också prövar snacka lite sin historia på engelsk. Jag tror att alla här kan på engelsk. Ja, andra fångarna slår henne på grund av att hon är spion. De andra fångarna ser på TV. I TV ser Leila Yunus är spion från Armenien. Armenien har ockuperat azeriska jura. Aha, hon är väldigt dålig dama. Vi måste slå henne. Det eller Arif Yunus. Arif Yunus är inte bara i Azerbaijan. I alla världen är väldigt populär historik, professor. Han har skrivit 8 böcker. Nu han också skriver en bok från fanatisk terrorism. Någon ser där islamisk terrorism. Det är också, jag tror, det kommer väldigt god bok. Ja, och massa journalister blir arrest. Någon, för exempel jag. Jag har fått väldigt god tid och jag flyttar till Georgia, därpå till Ukraina, därpå till Lituania. Därpå jag tackar med Akron, med Penn, med første selvfølgelig Bø kommune. Det tilbyr meg fribyforfatter, og jeg bor der. Barna mine der, også familien min, barna mine kone min også der, vi veldig glad, og vi takker med Bø kommune også. Ja, nå i Aserbajdsjan situasjon, det veldig dårlig. Her i fengselet masse politisk fangene. Jeg tenker nesten 166. Leila Yunus er grunnlagt den liste fra politisk fangene. Hun snakker mer om den problemen. Takk.
Før vi inviterer opp de andre, så har jeg lyst til å spørre deg om du kan fortelle litt om bakgrunnen for at du måtte flykte. Altså den, kan du fortelle det?
Ja, jeg også bor i Aserbajdsjan, masse problemer. Lille Jonsson er i fjorden, så er det her, det kjenner også masse ganger jeg blir arrest, og så slår meg i forskjellig tid, for eksempel i perioden Grand Prix. Ja, Grand Prix. Det myndighetene ødelagte der husene. Når han Ilham Aliyev tenkte vi veldig rik europeisk land, vi må bygge en ny hall. Og han der ødelagt masse huset, og så han ikke betalt kompensasjon. Og folk der selvfølgelig protesterer og kommer politisk og slår alle. Jeg der filmer og jeg blir veldig dårlig. Jeg slår meg veldig dårlig. Og så jeg i mitt land også blir en populær journalist. Jeg har fått 3 verdenpris i USA, Free Speech pris, og i UK Index on Censors pris, og så Martin Adler pris. Jeg også blir grunnlagt i en menneskerettighetsorganisasjon. IRFS, og myndighetene har stengt min organisasjon også i 6. august. Men jeg har en god venn, han jobber i politi, han har sagt at meg, du må flytte. Også ikke tenkte meg, jeg har kastet alle min liv, min karriere, min hus, også på vei min bil. Når tomt bensin, jeg kastet bare på vei min bil, og jeg tar en taxi. Jeg kommer direkte til Georgia. Jeg har ikke fått noen ting. Jeg har ikke sagt mye på vennene mine, på vennene mine, på foreldrene mine, alle andre. Jeg skal flytte. Og etter 10 timer, politiet kommer hos meg på min jobb, og jeg sjekker alt, og ønsker å arreste meg. Men min andre venn, Emil Hussein, han sitter der i Swiss ambassador i 10 måneder. Etter 10 måneder har jeg reist til Aserbajdsjan svensk statsminister, og han tatt Emil Hussein på sin fly til Swiss. Han bor nå i Swiss. Ja.
Ja, og vi har gjester fra Amsterdam. So then I would like to welcome up here the Yunus. Both of you can join us, please. Vi kan sitte. Please, I mean, welcome. Det blir litt mye fram og tilbake med språk. I'm sure we will be kind of confused about the language here. Is it possible to sit on that one?
Det litt dårlig helse.
Ja. It's okay. We have plenty of time. I think maybe I will be the microphone stand, so I can just hold it up when I want you to talk. Okay? Everything is fine. That's good.
Don't be difficult.
Okay. I think I would just give you the microphone, and then you can start to tell us about your background in human rights activities in Azerbaijan.
Hello? Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. You know, when you are 60 and go to prison, and after 60, you are not comfortable. So we both start our human rights activity as dissidents in Soviet Union. First time he was arrested by Soviet KGB in 1976. And for us was very strange that in 2014, when he stay in prison of Ministry of National Security in independent Azerbaijan Republic, in prison, they bring him his case from 1976 and told, we're looking for your family many, many years. You are our enemy from 1976. So you can imagine, nothing changed. Nothing. But what is the difference? That when we walk in Soviet Union, it was not so important to explain for journalists from Guardian or from German Bild what is mean Soviet Union, that it is a big multinational prison. Everybody understand. President Jimmy Carter understand, singer-songer understand, everybody understand. And we have great solidarity. We was not alone in Azerbaijan. We was together with our colleagues, dissidents from Ukraine, Latvia, Russia, Georgia. We was together. And we have solidarity from Amnesty International when I visited it in London in 1989. But after the fall of the Soviet Union, we stay in small national prison and stay alone. Each nation goes their own way. And my friends in Georgia succeed. They have free election, president election, parliament election, but we have authoritarian regime, something as in Middle Age. More horrible than it was in Soviet Union. Why I thought more horrible? Because in Soviet Union it was legislation. It was very bad legislation. For example, why he was arrested? Why I stayed under control of KGB? Because we published articles also abroad in France about with the criticize of the Soviet system. And it was against legislation. There was such article number 58 in Criminal Code of Soviet Union against Soviet propaganda against Soviet system. So we understand that we do something against legislation. In Azerbaijan, Criminal Code is wonderful. Legislation is wonderful, but all of us go to prison. Why? We did not broken the legislation. Khadija Ismailiu, we demanded independence from her, did not broken the legislation. But if you also, you criticize the so-called president, King Ilham Aliyev, not in newspapers, in your Facebook, so that I do not like this, you will be arrested. If you're a young boy, they put drugs in your pocket and you will go to prison that you have a lot of drugs, kilos of heroin. Yeah, if you are activist of opposition party, you will go to prison maybe as a hooligan. Somebody told that you beat him or her. If you are working as we for peaceful solution with the Karabakh conflict with Armenia, Georgia, and other Christian countries, spire. If you are just peaceful believers and visited mosque, it's your right to visit mosque, no problem. But if you visited mosque and you also criticized president, you will go to prison as an Islamic terrorist. Anyway, you will go to prison because you criticized. So if we compare and see our experience with the Soviet Union, Azerbaijan is a member of OSCE, member of Council of Europe. And now I will be told as a examples how we receive support from Council of Europe. First of all, I also was mentioned that who can be arrested in Azerbaijan if also you do not criticize the Aliyev's family. In Idrak's film, you see the photo of Professor Nowruz Ali Mamedov. He was a professor, a linguist. He is the author of the single dictionary in Azerbaijan on Talysh, Russian, Azerbaijan language. Talysh is a small national minority in the south of Azerbaijan, and Idrak is a representative of this minority. You see, he's not dangerous. Well, do you think he's dangerous? I don't know. But this professor did not criticize Aliyev, nothing. He was just professor linguist, language, dictionary, and he was chief editor of the single in Azerbaijan newspaper on Talysh language. It also was newspaper more for cultural issues. He was arrested as a spy of Iran, because Talysh nation also live in Iran and in Azerbaijan. And he was beaten very cruelly. He was about 70 years, that you must sign that you are spy. He refused. His eldest son brought every time food to prison. And every time when his eldest son, he was 33 years old, he was taken by the representative of mission, Minister of National Security, taken abroad from the city, and they beat him. One day he received during the night home on blood, and he died this night after beating, 33 years old. But father again refused to tell that he is a spy. Father received 10 years old prison, and after 1 year, father died in prison. Then the widow and the last son, youngest son, go by the car to the cemetery where was the father and the eldest son. And the big car push the small car with driving young son, and the young son also died. Yeah, and the mom also has windows, and mom now lives his widow in Netherlands, and she received political asylum. And when I put this name, when he was arrested, in the list of political prisoners, nobody did not support me also in my country around human rights defenders. They told that he's not a politician. There are no political motive in his arrest. He is not a member of opposition party. I said, come on. You see that they are afraid of the intellectual leaders of national minorities. If you are a representative of national minorities and you have respect in your community, you are dangerous for the family. So, you see, in this country you never know what will be with you. About another problems from my experience. In 1994, me and Arif, we created non-government organization Institute for Peace and Democracy for protection of human rights. And all my life I was working on preparing the list of political prisoners I mentioned. But our institute was so famous in our country, 9 million population in Azerbaijan, that I received a lot of letters which just mentioned Baku Leyla Yunus. No name of streets, no number of the building. And one day in 2009, the big group of the people from the small village on the north of Azerbaijan visited our office, and told that one family, father and mother, come, Medjidovs, that two girls from this family, 7 and 14 years old, was kidnapping. And no information. And the whole village rushed to find the kidnappers, and they find it was three guys from another village. And during the investigation, these guys signed all documentation and gave all information that they kidnapped girls during five last years by the order of the chief of police of this region and the deputy chief of police for trafficking. And our office was visited also by another family, which mentioned that our daughters, 19, 20 years old, was kidnapped. And this guy mentioned that first time they received order to kidnap such young girls, 7, 14. And the mother of the another girls told that when she applied to police and told that no information about my daughter, she is about 20 years old, the police told she has boyfriend, she escaped with her boyfriend to Russia to live, so don't worry. And we organized a press conference in Baku with lawyers from victims, the girls, and lawyers from these guys, and give all information with the names of the police colonel who ordered to kidnap, how many money they pay for each girl, and so on and so on. And we demanded that the trial start, that the judge invited to trial this police, chief of police and his deputy, and start the investigation and give all explanation. And we show on the press conference the documents which were signed by these guys who kidnapped girls and also by, was signed by investigator. But judge did not invite the colonel from police. These guys received 14 years prison and no attention. Minister of Interior Office start trial against me that I blame the honor of the police officers. And one day, I received information that they are preparing to kidnap our single daughter. We was lucky that these days our daughter Dinara was abroad. We prohibited her to come to Baku and we bring her to Netherlands. She received political asylum to Netherlands. So we understand that it's so horrible. It was in 2009. In 2011, we have a new guest in our office. Ilham Aliyev are preparing for Eurovision Sing Song. And they want to create a new buildings, new parks and so on. And they decided to destroy the old buildings where live people. And they just destroyed. And people who don't want, it was against legislation. It's my home. I have all documentation for this home. I do not want to left by legislation. You cannot. But the kingdom told, I won't build here park. And we gathered all this information, did research, explained that it's against constitution and so, and I gave interview to New York Times and my interview about horrible violation of the right of property, right of property for the citizens in Baku was published 10 of August 2011 in New York Times newspaper. And 11 August 2011 in evening time, at that day I was here in Norway, was invited to the Norway Helsinki Committee. My colleague called me and said that 9 p.m. in the evening, the bulldozer came and destroyed our home, which was our office, with everything. Library, archive, computers, everything just destroyed. Without any explanation, without any court decision. We apply to court when we return. The court has decisions that they must pay us money for on the legislation asking. But from 2011, we did not receive one penny. But we continued to work. And I'm preparing the list of political prisoners and working on this. And in 2012, Parliament Assembly of Council of Europe adopted the special rapporteur on the problem of political prisoners in Azerbaijan. And it was German deputy, Christopher Strasser. But he did not receive visa to come to Baku. He's special rapporteur on Azerbaijan, and he did not receive visa. And Council of Europe keeps silent. We work very closely with the office of deputy Christopher Strasser. And finally, he preparing the project of resolution with the name of the political prisons in Azerbaijan. And in the session of Parliament Assembly in January 2013, it was discussed this resolution. And during the discussion, several of deputies had a speech against this resolution. One of them was Italian diplomat. He was the deputy of the chairman of the Parliament Assembly of Council of Europe. And now, I must say that I'm very happy, the Procuratura in Milan start investigation against this deputy that he received money from our government. But the second deputy who has free time speech against this resolution, political prisons in Azerbaijan, was a Spanish deputy, Pedro Argamont. And where is he now, Pedro Argamont? He is the president of Parliament Assembly of Council of Europe. So my congratulations to Council of Europe. And finally, the deputies in Parliament Assembly of Council of Europe gave voice against this resolution. And it was in January 2013. And 4 of February 2013 started repression. Ilgar Mamedov, the chairman of the opposition movement in Azerbaijan, Real Republican Alternative, was arrested the first. And still this young man stay in prison. In May 2014, European Court for Human Rights has a decision that his arrest was illegally against this articles of European Convention for Human Rights, but he still stay in prison. From May 2014 till November 2014, Azerbaijan was the chairman in the Committee of Ministers of Council of Europe. And during this period, all of us go to prison. All our activists, human rights defenders, journalists, we was accused as the spies of Armenia, Khadija economic issues, and so on. And now we come to Norway with the invitation of Helsinki Committee, Norwegian Helsinki Committee, and our friends in Helsinki Committee, and Indrak told that, you know, Leila, frankly, we did not believe that we can see you on freedom. And it also questions about what do you think, why you're on freedom. I think it's necessary to talk about our opinion. How was in prison, maybe Arifel told. But I think that our president did not think to give us freedom. But price for oil go down. It was more than 100 and it's coming for 40, 35. He need money. And we was very ill and Parliament Assembly, European Parliament, they succeed. They received permission to send doctor, first of all, to me and Arif, and the doctor told that Arif has blood pressure 2015 for 114, and they are afraid that if he will die, it will be problems. So never received freedom. And last point which I want to say, it was mentioned the European Games in Azerbaijan, and I mentioned the Eurovision. And you know what I am feeling, that it's very important, and we here also try to give, to create public opinion in Europe that all our generation, all of us know what is the Soviet Union. And when it was Olympic Games last century, it was two big mistake. One, it was in 1936, when it was Olympic Games in Germany, where already Nazi was on the power, Hitler was the chief. And second, it was in 1980 in Soviet Union. And I remember that more sportsmen from democratic country refused to go to Moscow. And 27th of July 2014, I write the letter to Patrick Hickey, the chairman of the Olympic Committee of First European Games. And I write that you will do great mistake to organize it first European Games in Baku, in authoritarian country. Remember, it was in Germany and it was in Soviet Union. It was mistake. You continued mistake. Patrick Hickey received more money from our government, and he was arrested in Brazil, in Rio de Janeiro.
Yeah, yeah.
This year. But why, when we write about this, no attention. But when he received money in Brazil, in Rio de Janeiro, they finally arrested him. Okay. But not only sportsmen must understand that it's shame to take part in such games in the authoritarian country, but also famous singers. You know, I stayed in prison and I watched TV where famous American singer Lady Gaga, she received $2 million from Ilham Aliyev, our king, and she sings song about freedom. What do you think we can feel? Me, Khadija, Arif, all of us in prison. Julio Iglesias sing song. Come on, you need money? You are poor people? It's shame. It's necessary that Amnesty International, which working for freedom for political prisoners, also mentioned the list of such singers, of such actors who received money and came and support authoritarian regime. It's necessary that they cannot using this. It's necessary that the deputies from your country, from France, who go to Parliament Assembly of Council of Europe, they have responsibility. They did not took money from authoritarian regime. And if we will not be together, Muslim, Christians, Jewish, together for your and our freedom, our country can follow this experience which we have in Arabic worlds. You know, after the fall of the Soviet Union, about 50 years in 2005-2006, I took part in international conference, and as today I told about dictator regime in Azerbaijan, and experts as Svante Korner, Brenda Schaffertz, experts, one from Sweden, told, no, you need transition period, Leila. Azerbaijan slowly will improve for democracy, as Mubarak, Egypt, Syria. Where is this now, these experts? Wonderful improvement for democracy in Tunis, in Egypt, in Syria. If we will not do attention for possibility for evolution for democratic reforms in such authoritarian country as former Soviet, first of all, former Soviet Muslim countries, which now all of them stay under dictatorship. This experience, this will be repeated. A huge number of migrants from Syria coming in Europe. It's necessary to stop migrants from former Soviet Union today. Do not wait the war in our regions. Because the situation in these countries, it's really horrible. You never know. You will be arrested, or you can stay at home, or your home will be demolished, or your children can be kidnapping. You live in more horrible situation than in Soviet Union. It was a great, it was a rule of law, as I mentioned. You live in more horrible situation than it was in Middle Ages. Because also in Middle Ages, it was some flexible, you understand the situation. It was king, and you understand that he's king. But now...
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, thanks, I finished.
I'm just wondering, because you were mentioning these singers who came and did business in your country. And I am inevitably thinking about Statoil from Norway, which is the biggest contractor, isn't it right? For oil contractor in Azerbaijan. Azerbaijan is the third, Azerbaijan er den tredje største oljeprodusenten i verden, større enn Norge. Og Statoil, altså vi, er da en viktig kontraktør i det markedet. So, what do you think of them being there? And they say that they are there to show the good way of doing business. What's your comment on that?
First of all, thank you very much. Thank you very much for your attention to our country, to our problems, because it's very important for us, for our region. And thank you very much for your question, because in Azerbaijan we say that Norway is a country where oil play a big role, and we have the two way. One to Norway. Because Norway for us, for our society, play a role, a symbol of good way for good life condition. And another way to Nigeria, also it's an oil country where there's many oil and gas. And in our society, many times we discuss about this two way, to Norway or to Euro integration, sorry, and to the Nigerian. And of course, our authority many times says to the chief of the European countries, to representatives of the West structures, Europe Parliament, Parliament Assembly of Council European, that our authority says, don't demand to us, don't say any words about the democratic reform. You need our oil, you need our gas, it's enough. In another problem, it's our internal problems. Of course, we are member of Council of Europe, but business is business, democracy is democracy. It's not same. And unfortunately, that sometimes we look the bad picture that officially many of European politics say that good words about democracy, but in reality, we look another picture. Not only in Azerbaijan, also look at the picture in the Middle East region, in Iraq, in another country. That's why it's a big problem. Oil and democracy, energy resource and democracy reforms. With Statoil, of course, Statoil is not don't play a role as, for example, British Petroleum, of course. And when we say about the, we know the first time Statoil played good role. It's truth.
Yeah.
And the representative of the Norway government, I say about the ambassadors of Norway in our country, also support us, support the representative of the civil society in our country. And for example, former ambassador of Norway in our country, Steinar Gill, for our society, for our people, he's, for us, he's a national, our national hero.
Yeah.
Yes, when we go to the, our streets, many people say, this is our ambassadors. Don't say that this is the officially ambassador of Norway in Azerbaijan. No, they say he is a good man. Because it's play, it big, this factor play a big role. But one day, we look another picture when Statoil don't play good role for our society also. And we criticize, published many criticized articles about this policy of Statoil in our country. But again, Statoil is not British Petroleum. It's not American oil companies in our country.
It's not big role.
Okay. Yes.
Men
jag tänker att Statoil också har en roll där där också har man massa massa investeringar.
Ja.
Ja. Faktiskt Statoil också hjälper den corruption liksom.
Ja. Så det är komplicerat. It's complicated. I also have another question I would like to ask you all, because I was thinking when you were you Leila were telling about the situation in the Soviet period, and then you I guess in 1989 and when the Soviet Union collapsed, you thought this is our now this is the new era.
Yeah.
Now we have the freedom to build a new society based on democratic democratic society.
It was such a dream.
It was a dream come true, yes. But then that didn't happen, and now you have a dictatorship. Actually.
Yeah.
Do you see any way out of this situation? What is the way out of this situation? Do you think?
Yeah.
Does it have to be a war also in Azerbaijan, like we have seen in many other countries?
Yeah.
You know, every time think about this. How it will be, what is the possibility. For example, Belarus have Lukashenko, he is also can be president forever. Country has no oil, has no gas, very close to Russia, but after revolution in Ukraine, Lukashenko afraid from Putin and try to be more independent that. And when it was repression against political activists in Belarus, the Europe organized sanction against Belarus. So it was sanctioned, it's prohibited to representative from government, first of all, Procuratura, Minister of Internal Office who put people in prison, to receive Schengen visa, to have bank account in Europe and so on. And to when I spoke with the representative of State Department, European Parliament, and told that it's necessary that such sanction will be against Azerbaijan, the reply was, but we did not achieve nothing in Belarus. But today, in Belarus, we have just one political prisoner.
Yeah.
In Azerbaijan today, 166. And in Belarus, we did not receive a lot of information about tortures, that the people died as a result of tortures. No. But in Azerbaijan, each year about 10 people die as a result of tortures. So I think we must be together in solidarity with the human rights activists, civil society in Azerbaijan. It's very important that it will be, we will try to create it not only a list of political prisoners, but also a list of criminals in our government, the representatives of from Ministry of Internal Office who tortured people and the people died, the investigators who organized the tortures against Arif, and you see he is ill, and all of our colleagues, they tortured them, they beat them, the list with the judges who sent in prison people who are not guilty. And it's necessary that this list will be very well known in Europe, in the United States, and that these people cannot receive Schengen visa, cannot have here bank account. It's necessary that it will be sanctioned, that this unity campaign team, unity team in Azerbaijan under the Ilham Aliyev government, they will be not so comfortable. They must feel this. And it's very important to support people in this region for peace. For example, Drag shown the film, this Karabakh conflict. 20% of Azerbaijan territory occupied by the, our neighbors, Armenia. But who enjoy of this? Not only Armenians, but also our President Ilham Aliyev. He created the public opinion that we must be together with such president against Armenians, our enemy. But when we find in Armenia, in Azerbaijan, people who try to organize a peace dialogue, we created first and single in Azerbaijan common Azerbaijan-Armenian website where we organized public dialogue between students, actors, representatives of the student community. It's prohibited. It's necessary that do not think for peaceful solution to spoke just with the president of both countries, spoke with the society. Try to organize it, support more society for peaceful solution. And do not give money. They again will be asked money from European Union, again from another international bank, World Bank. Do not give him money. He quite a lot. And we will try from our side for solidarity with all political prisoners and so on. It's necessary to stop support such a dictator regime. The last word, when we live in Soviet Union, we did never believe that the Soviet Union can be for one day. Nobody did not believe. The price for oil go so much down that it was $10 for barrels. And Gorbachev can't do nothing. First of all, it was economic reason. Then it was political reasons. We have no nothing to eat in Soviet Union. And it was such. And Yeltsin's come and so on. Oil price will go down, did not give money. For one day, now the people go on the street with social slogans. The people will go on the street, will be struggle, will be... It's necessary that he will escape. He will escape when we will did not... if he did not receive international support, and his team understand that they also are very well known abroad, and they cannot come for political asylum in Norway, they will be not struggle. It's necessary that it will be solidarity with the peaceful struggle for human rights in such countries as Azerbaijan.
Sometimes our colleagues on the West don't understand situation in our region, because officially Azerbaijan, for example, concrete Azerbaijan is a member of the Council of Europe, a member of the many international institutes. Officially Azerbaijan is a democracy republic with election, president, parliament election, where is officially independent mass media and so. But this kind of picture will look in another former Soviet Republic also. But in reality, it is not a really picture, because big problem, I think the problem of number one for former Soviet sphere, it's a political system. We change only name. Former the general secretary of the Communist Party, today is the president. By constitution in the Soviet time, person number two, prime minister, don't play any role. Today also, our prime minister don't play any role. In the Soviet time, local authority don't play any role. Today also. The name of the ruling party changed from the Communist Party to the new Azerbaijan Party. Change only name, but not political system. On the former Soviet Republic, only two countries, Ukraine and Georgia, changed this political system. Another republic, and Russia also. Baltic state today is part of the European system. I say without, of course, Baltic states, only two republics, Ukraine and Georgia, changed this political former political system with strong centralization to the parliament republics. But another so former Soviet Republic don't change this system. That's why we say about the future social crisis, first of all, on the Central Asia region and in our country. Because you know, these republics look at the authoritarian policy, and where the authority have sometimes don't understand. Don't want the listen of opposition. They know only one policy, repression policy. Know the one culture, monologue culture, not dialogue culture. That's why we it's a problem number one. Change the former political system.
Yes. We could have continued, but we have to take a break. And you will have some better chairs to sit in. And vi tar en pause efter det jeg sa. Nå jeg språkforvirret. Da kan det gå og ta dere vatten, eller kaffe, eller twist, eller hva du vil. Det er toalett rett ned trappa. Og så er det mulig å skrive navnene sine på listene her hos Amnesty. Og så er vi tilbake om 5 minutter og skal snakke om Bangladesh. Gi deg en stor klapp.